Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him will not be condemned, but whoever does not believe has already been condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the verdict, that the light came into this world, but people preferred darkness to light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come towards the light, so that his works might not be exposed. But whoever lives the truth comes to the light, so that his works may be clearly seen as done in God."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Again, we celebrate today Lautari Sunday, hence some of the pink that you might be seeing. It's a color of rejoicing. Lautari comes from the Latin and means that rejoice in Christ. And we rejoice in particularly in the hope that we have in Christ. Now, we have to ask ourselves, well, what exactly does that mean? What is hope? Well, we know what hope is by what we know that it what it is not. Hope is not something that you can see. It's not optimism. A hopeful person is different than an optimist. Hope is something that we have that's living. It's alive. We live in accordance to our hope that we have. And the hope that we have is alive, and it's trustworthy. It's a trustworthy hope. It's not something that we can necessarily just because I hope in something, it's going to come to true. No. We know that it was going to come true, and that's why we hope in it. It's trustworthy. Now, in understanding our hope, the hope that we have in Christ, and to fill ourselves with the hope and to rejoice in that hope, it takes recollection. It takes recollection, and the whole purpose of Lent is that we get off of the hamster wheel a little bit of our daily lives, our daily grind, and we recollect upon God and what he has for us in our life. What is he saying to us? And are we listening? And are we remembering who we are in Christ, the great dignity that we have in him? We say every responsorial psalm in Mass, they're repeated. The verses are repeated. Today, let my tongue be silenced if I ever forget you, O Lord. Let my tongue be silenced if I ever forget you, O Lord. Other ones is, oh, praise the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. And it goes on, and then it says, praise the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Do you got it? Do you got it? Do you got it? It's repeated again. So we don't forget these things, and we remember them. You see it throughout the Old Testament, you know, when God did a great work, they would want to build something in stone to remember that this is what God did for us. Let us never forget what he did. And let us never forget who we are in him. How important that is. Let me give you a little bit of an illustration, a story about the power of, recollection, which is basically a principle of the Carmelite order. During their seminarian years, a spiritual director told me, he says, you know, go down to the Carmelite monastery and go talk to one of the sisters down there. They call a spiritual sister, and she'll pray for you throughout your time in seminary. So I went down there, and as I was waiting behind the grill for the sisters to come out, I had never been to one of these situations before. I noticed that waiting there with me was a man and a woman, and the woman was very, very beautiful and professionally dressed, and it looked like the man was holding a camera of some kind, and I just wanted to know, who are these people? So I asked them, you know, are you guys here to visit friends? And the woman said to me, she says, no, I used to be a Carmelite. I was a discalced Carmelite. And I said, oh, wow, that's something. And she's coming back and I said, well, why did you decide to, you know, leave? She said, well, when I was in Carmel, everybody kept telling me how restricted my life would be. How is it that you're living in such a small, narrow confines of this world in Carmel? You know, you're kind of in this rigid schedule, and you're doing all these things. And she said that her idea was just to pray, you know, seek God more and more. And then she said that, and then so she wound up leaving, and she left, and she actually was working as a very good pretty successful, I guess, reporter in Miami. She was on the news, and she was successful. She said that, you know, I have a great career. I have a beautiful condo that's overlooking Biscayne Bay. I have a fiance. I have all, you know, nice car, and I have basically all the freedom that I could want. And she says, but you know something, I can't help but saying that the time that right now, she says, I'm back here now because I like to talk to them, but you know, to be honest with you, right now my life feels so constricted and so small and so rigid and so, tightly wrapped. But when I was a sister, everything was so big. Everything was so big. People were so big. Life was so big. So it shows you the power of, you know, really, you know, it's not even our place, but it's the place that we're at with God that really affects our soul. It affects our soul, affects our life, and that has to do with recollection, remembering who God is, being in a place of listening to what His voice says to us. You know, in the second reading today that we see, it says, you know, St. Paul says to them, he says, brothers and sisters, get this. God, who is rich in mercy, and because of His great love for us, even while we were dead in transgressions, Christ died for us. Okay, and He raised us up. We love Him because He first loved us. And it is by grace that you are saved. It is by this grace of God, this hope in God, this life in God, that is Christ. That we have life. Recollect on these things. You know, have these in your mind. Remember this. I want you to know that He says these things. He says that we are God's handiwork. We are created in Christ Jesus for the good works that God has prepared for us to do. The things that you can do that nobody else can do, and only you can do them. Right now, guaranteed, you are the only person that might be praying, that might have a chance to pray for somebody. It might be you. If you don't do it, no one will. But you know, this is again the incredible drama of our free will. We can choose. You can choose. We have that choice. Continually. Saint Therese, before she died, she says, "All is grace. All is hope. It's all in God. That's what it all is. This whole life." And Augustine said that, you know, God crowns His own gifts upon us. All of our merits and all of the good, those are things that God has already given us to do and to walk in. Finally, when we come to our gospel today, we see that the Lord says, whoever lives the truth comes to the light, because so that His works may be clearly seen as done in God. Whoever is in harmony with God, he has no problem with it. He's happy to be in Christ. He's happy to he's embracing the things of God in his life and he wants them, and he hungers for them. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall be filled. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. And, as we come to the third quarter here of our Lenten journey, you know, let's see if there's any place that we need to recollect upon the hope of God, the living hope that we have in Christ, in whom there is no shadow, no hiding, that we might have perfect clarity in our conscience, freedom from any guilt or fear, and the unprofitable works of darkness, and be filled with the light of Christ. Amen.